There was something that happened here that changed or impacted on all those who came through here. And that experience that happened here, that story was not well known. So for me, what it is because I've lived here, I've experienced it, my own thinking was simply to make it part of the overall narrative, and that there were those unique stories of pain, suffering, discovery, renewal here, just like there was in the other areas.
We have within our group here, we have 43 people who have put out money to come on this inaugural tour. A number of them are from Ontario. How many of you came from Ontario? Yeah. How many of you are from...
My name is David Brian
BC?
Iwaasa. I'm a third generation Japanese Canadian. I was born in Raymond, Alberta. I did my primary education and secondary education here in Southern Alberta, in Raymond, and I went to the University of Lethbridge. At the end of my undergraduate program at the University of Lethbridge, the university offered a scholarship for a summer, and it was $1,000, and you could pick any topic you wanted. I applied to write a history of the Japanese Canadians in Southern Alberta. And as part of and an extension of my work on the history of the Japanese in Southern Alberta, I began to realize that very few people knew about it. And so that's why I wrote a number of things on different aspects, and the sugar beet experience is one of them. That industry, with all its ups and downs and the problems and challenges it had, continued on until we experienced this situation in 1942. Some 3,000, at least at the outset, chose to come to the sugar beet fields, and they chose because they could come as a family and work together in the sugar beets. The Japanese Canadian workers that came were an answer to the prayers of the farmers at that time, and in a sense, Southern Alberta was an answer to the needs of those people that came at that time.
We had, so when they brought out the War Measures Act, our family had 24 hours to get on the train because we wanted to stay together. And because we had a big family, 10 children, we were the prime people that the farmers in Raymond and Southern Alberta were looking for.
So I felt that there was a need for people to at least know something about that. And so then came up this idea of this bus tour. First day of the tour, essentially, is all of us gathering together and departing. Thanks to the skill of our driver, we made it down safely to Lethbridge. And that's where we've encountered our first sessions with the local groups. And it always was sort of a hope that our group and the local groups would meet together. The other thing is how many people are, quote, related in various ways. People found long-lost friends, discovered long-lost relatives. Not that they had anticipated it, but that they just came out in the shared stories.
They're all related.
This is Takejiro Koyata.
That's my grandfather.
Really? Who are you?
I was adopted, so people don't know about me.
Well, you're my relative, because Grandpa Koyata is, like, as far as we know, all of the Koyatas in the world are related.
I think the Nikkayuko Japanese Gardens is sort of interesting. For Southern Alberta, it was the construction of that was sort of the first sort of expression of this sort of permanency of the Japanese community in Southern Alberta. And that the small Japanese Canadian community in Southern Alberta should spearhead this and ensure that it was done right, I think is a tribute to the local community. And also, I think a very clear message that we are here and we are a part of the community. Second day, this one is an interesting. We went to the Galt Museum. I think it highlights the fact that there is some scholarship that is now being put to this experience. Also the fact that the Galt Museum is beginning to understand that it has a bit of a responsibility to be able to explain and portray that part of the history of Southern Alberta. Next we travel to Raymond. Raymond's special to me because that's where I was born and that's where I grew up. But it also is interesting that I think for Raymond, there's a bit of a discovery that's taking place too. Frankly, the Raymond Museum has never done in its total existence a special exhibit on anybody, let alone on the Japanese. And that's important because although the Japanese population was fairly large at one point in time, especially at the height of the evacuation, it's declined significantly. And now there are not that many left in Raymond. And so there is a risk and a danger of that experience and that story being lost.
It certainly brings back memories for me. This, by the way, is a sugar beet, and this, by the way, is your dessert. We're going to pass it around.
So, growing up, my parents, they didn't talk about the war experience. In fact, I was so naive that at one time I was looking through one of the photo albums and saw some postcards of Banff. And I said, when did you get these? And my mom said, oh, they went back to visit Banff. And she said, well, we had been there once before. And I said, oh, when was that? She said, just at the wartime. I said, well, I didn't know that. And again, I never twigged because I was quite ignorant of everything that had happened. And so, in fact, the train brought them through Banff. So when I was looking at this postcard, I was thinking, pleasant memories of your first stop in Banff. And it was just the opposite. It was, a nightmare. I was telling my wife when we were talking about the sugar beet tour, and I think it was last night, I was telling her about my experience as a younger boy, sort of working on the farm. And she said, you've never told me that. And I said, yeah, I guess I haven't. So she said, she reminded me, well, we need to write this down so that it can be passed on.
I went up there one time to just visit my grandfather's grave and my own parents' graves, and it's sort of weird that I gained such pleasure in walking around in a cemetery, but I did. I looked at the gravestones and began thinking about the lives that each one of those gravestones represent. And then, of course, there's the large stone plaque there about the ashes that had been abandoned, in a sense, in the various Buddhist churches along the West Coast. And then during the evacuation and the dispersal from the coast, that the authorities did not even want to have Japanese ashes left there. So if we're talking about ethnic cleansing, this was a really sort of a pretty complete effort to do that. The other interesting thing is the only place that they could send it was the only operating Buddhist temple left in Canada at that time, which was the one in Raymond. And that's why it got there. And so there we have all these people that perished along the BC coast, that their ashes are now interred on the Bald Prairie in Alberta. And I think that's another interesting thing that comes from that, is that as the Japanese-Canadian community, the population in Southern Alberta declines, not because of discrimination or any of that, it's just part of the urbanization of the country, that the young people are going to the larger cities. And so these little communities where Japanese Canadians played a very, very important role in part, that part of the community is disappearing. And it won't be very long where there's hardly anybody left, and people will go to the cemetery and say, where did all these people come from? And why are they here? And I think we need to make sure that the story is preserved so that people know why they were here. Next day. Then we travel out to Picture Butte. There's not a lot to see anymore in Picture Butte, but you could see that people who had lived there had memories of it, and that things happened there that affected people's lives.
We pretty well grew up in Southern Alberta around Picture Butte. When we were growing up, and my parents, they just had to work so hard, and oftentimes it was from early in the morning to late at night. And before my youngest sister was born, it was basically the four of us. My parents would be out in the field, and it would be late at night. I don't know what sort of hours it was, but our house had a root cellar, and my mom and dad just didn't know what to do with us, that they couldn't sort of hire anybody to look after us or anything like that. So they usually, you know, put us down into the root cellar where there's no electricity or light and that sort of thing. And they basically said, you know, we'll be home when we get home. We had a talk, and I asked them, you know, don't you feel bitter? You know, that you've been wrong? And he says, no. He says, you get disappointed, but, you know, it's not a long-term sort of thing where people don't keep on carrying it on and on and on. You just move on. And he says, when you look at the Japanese people, the Japanese Canadians, and you look at where they are today, how they've overcome the adversities, even though that they may not have been the same sort of generation that of his generation, they want to be successful at whatever they did, you know. And that's my father prided himself in being the best farmer that he could be.
And then we had our first opportunity to go to a sugar beet field and to see real sugar beets. And it's fascinating to see a bunch of city folk that had never been in a field before trampling through the mud.
You had a choice to do sugar beets or go to the internment camps, what they're called, ghost towns. We decided that we wanted the family together, so we would do sugar beets. Sugar beets was slave labor at slave labor wages. If you really worked hard, you could get ahead, but it meant a lot of work. It meant pulling the sugar beets out and slapping it together to knock the dirt off and putting in windrows, and then coming along later and stab it with a hook on the end of a knife and take the tops off. We worked hard. We worked out. We would pull the beets after dark till midnight. If you worked hard like that, you had a chance to get ahead.
Okay, well, so I may have started out in the field when I was 7 or 8. It was tedious work. So you would leave every 12 inches, you would leave one beet. You couldn't cut it out. Once we were young, we would just help out, but it wasn't long. By the time we were in grade 6 or 7, we were expected to work. So we would go to school and come home and do beets. But it was hard work, and it was our life.
Well, how did your mom and dad cope, like when they came? I mean, you did a lot, but how did they cope with being here, and what did they do that you can remember?
They have a saying amongst the Japanese people. Mm-hmm. It's called shikatanga nai. Mm. Yeah. So if you can't change it, you kind of live with it.
And a number of questions about how sugar beets were grown and how it's cared for and harvested and the economics of it. I wouldn't have thought that they would be that interested, but they were. And some people wanted to take a sugar beet back home with them. And that shows you that sense for them of discovery, of learning about a plant that they didn't know anything about. And also to understand that this lowly root, is the reason why lives were uprooted and people were moved and people had to suffer through so many experiences, all on behalf of this little beet. And it's almost as if we reached Mecca. this was the highlight of the pilgrimage, that we were finally made it that far. Like any pilgrimage, it has to come to an end at some point in time. But I think, like a good pilgrimage, I think there's a feeling of fulfillment on the part of those that participated, that they feel that it was worth the effort. And as any good pilgrimage, it's a reinforcement of the faith. And so I think there's a lot more interest in this story.
It was great. Everybody was so kind and helpful. And I think we all gained something. I'd encourage anybody to go on these. I'd like my kids to go on it.
In spite of the fact, even on this trip, you hear heartbreaking stories about the hardships that families endured. But at the same time, you hear the positives of lives that were built out of that difficult situation. And that says something about the resilience of people. But I want to do whatever I can to sort of make that kind of history personal, in that it's going to be our family's story. I'm one of these older grandfathers, and they're a little bit young yet, but I want to make sure that I collect whatever I can so that someday, when they become curious about family and where they've come from, that we'll have it there.
Just recently I read something where David Suzuki was really supporting as far as the Japanese-Canadian identity and that sort of thing. And he says, and I don't know what the exact quote was, but it was basically that we've been wronged, but it is up to us to educate people that we have been wronged. And I find that so often.
I think we can learn that given the right opportunity and the right experiences, that everyone can learn to work together and to avoid stereotyping and moving into ghettoizing or separating, segregating the different groups and peoples. And I think that's something that we need to know. And hopefully through these experiences, learn that it can be done and needs to be done.